What are the variables that a company must control to successfully implement a marketing strategy? What does it mean, marketing mix? What are its models and how can it help organizations? Welcome to my 9th digital marketing lesson, and today we will talk about marketing mix. You will learn how to use and master it to improve your business bottom line. I'm gonna show you the 4 P's of marketing mix, the evolution of marketing mix, so the 7 P's, the 8 P's, the 4 C's and the 7 C's. And then I will explain you how to use marketing mix for successful marketing strategies. A marketing mix is the pillar of a marketing strategy and consists of a series of tools that guide the company in the ups and downs of its industry. It drives decision making during the whole process of bringing a product to the market. And there are many models of marketing mix that have followed over time. Let's see what they are and how they evolved. This image represents the first model that was presented in Basic Marketing, a Managerial Approach by an American marketing professor and author Edmund Jerome McCartney in 1960. And he classified various marketing activities and grouped them under 4 dimensions: product, price, place, promotion. The first dimension is product, what satisfies consumers' needs and wants. And it answers to the question, what is being sold? And it can be tangible, like an actual good, or intangible, like a service, an ideas, or even an experience. It groups all the marketing decisions connected to the aspect, design, and characteristics of a product or service. But what are the main components of a product? Marketing and management of Kotler and Keller has identified 5 components of a product. This is the 5 product levels model and gives you an idea of how much a company can improve a product. The first, the potential product, is what the product can become in the future. It includes all the upgrades and modifications that a business can make to increase its life. The augmented product represents all the additional services and goods like installation, complementary products, after sales or customer service, warranty, shipping, credits, and so on. The expected product represents the benefits and features that consumers expect. The actual or generic product is the basic item with essential features. This element is fundamental for startups because in their early stages, they must generate profit as soon as possible and might not have time or resources to develop a full and accessorized product. In this case, it's called Minimum Viable Product, MVP. A simple version with just enough features to satisfy early consumers and provide feedback for future improvements. Examples of variables can be the product quality, brand, design, packaging, characteristics, and others. The core need and benefit is the main reason why a consumer should buy the product and represents the fundamental need or want to satisfy. Let's consider a hotel. The core is represented by a place where people can rest or sleep. The actual product can be towels, a bed, a closet. Instead, the expected product means taking for granted that the towels are clean, the bathroom is clean, that the mattress is soft, and so on. The augmented product can be the Wi-Fi, the room service, a free map of the town, and so on. Finally, the potential product can be made by placing treats for the guests in their room, or by building a new spa or a gym inside the hotel. This same scheme can be shrunk and adapted for services, which they consist of 3 components: delivery process, supplementary services, and core service. In 1999, Christopher Lovelock and Jochen Wirtz group the best facilitating and enhancing elements to service delivery in the Flower of Service model, which is described in their book Services Marketing. As you can see from this image, facilitating elements are information which guides consumers in the purchase process and educates them on sales conditions, terms of use, pricing, and other useful details needed for a mindful purchase. Order taking, that is a critical contact phase between company and consumers because it represents how the company fulfills transactions. It includes constant feedback on transaction progress, questions or other problems. If a customer is left without feedback, they will soon become frustrated. Payment is the transaction itself and determines when a prospect becomes a client. Billing must be clear, precise, and sent on time. People want to know how, when, and what they are paying for. The enhancing elements are represented by consultation, which includes all the distinguishing characteristics of a proper tailor consultancy. In fact, consumers want to buy expertise, knowledge, and a quality experience. Hospitality stands for the refreshment and comfortable waiting area and all those attentions necessary to make customers feel welcome. Safekeeping represents a business capability to keep customers' records safe and private. A safekeeping failure can compromise the trust between seller and buyer. Exceptions are also critical in services because they make clients feel special and increase their loyalty bond to the brand. But what is one of the most critical aspects to consider in the product dimension of a marketing mix? This critical aspect is managing products and services through their life cycle. In 1966, the American economist Raymond Vernon formulated the product life cycle theory. He said that a product or a service has a limited life and sales go through stages of ups and downs. For this reason, offerings need a specific marketing strategies for each phase of their life cycle. This theory breaks down a product or service life cycle in 5 stages according to the revenue generated over time. As you can see from this image, companies develop new products and services all the time, but only a small percentage reaches the market after the validation stage. During the introduction, the offering is promoted and consumers become aware of its existence. Revenues are still low, but they are going to grow exponentially in the next phase, which is growth. The demand and awareness grow. Sales increase on a par with profits and production costs decrease. Competitors enter the market with their version of the product or service. In the phase of maturity, the offering is now well known. The demand tends to stabilize and sales slow down. The industry is characterized by a thick competition, which pushes the company to decrease prices in order to maintain the leadership. The market saturates and the company must activate some differentiating strategies to acquire new consumers. According to marketing and management of Kotler and Keller, it can expand the market modification, change or improve the quality, features or style of the product or service, and this is called product modification, and edit non-product related elements such as communication, price and distribution. As soon as the offering becomes obsolete, sales and revenues drop till it's not convenient to continue making the product or service anymore, and this is the decline phase. This theory should make marketers understand that people have different readiness to adopt a product or service. In fact, in 1962, the American communication theorist and sociologist Everett Rogers described the timing for innovation adoption in his work Diffusion of Innovations. As you can see from this graph, the product adoption curve divides adopters in 5 groups. Innovators are pioneers who love new ideas and test new products for a cheaper price. They allow companies to discover offerings' weaknesses. Early adopters are visionaries or opinion leaders who seek new technology to acquire a drastic competitive advantage. They are usually less price sensitive and appreciate personalized solutions and superior customer support. The early majority is composed by pragmatists who buy a product or service only when its benefits are proven. They represent the mainstream market. Late majority is made up by conservatives who avoid the risk and prefer buying from a cheaper price. Laggards are skeptics who resist the innovation and prefer convenience rather than novelty. If companies want to move their innovation through a product or a service lifecycle, they have to tailor their marketing strategy for each group of consumers. And to do so, they can use the AIDA method. This acronym was first presented in 1898 by an American advertiser who said, "The mission of an advertisement is to attract a reader so that he will look at the advertisement and start to read it, then to interest him, so that he will continue to read it, then to convince him, so that when he has read it, he will believe it. If an advertisement contains these three qualities of success, it is a successful advertisement. And this model, based on attracting attention, maintaining the interest, creating desire and taking action, can use for both traditional and digital activities. But on this video, I want just to give you an overview of it, because in my digital marketing strategies, I use the inbound methodology that I will explain in another video. So if you are asking if you can use it, yeah, you can use it. Above all for landing pages, sales pitch, and other marketing activities like this. The second dimension of a marketing mix is the price. Price is the cost to buy a product or a service. For consumers, it represents the money to attain certain benefits from a product or a service, but it doesn't have only a monetary value. In fact, it includes consumers' perceived value and their sacrifice in terms of effort and time to purchase that product or service. Price is a critical and fundamental dimension for the marketing mix, because it is the only element which generates profit. All the other dimensions of the marketing mix generate costs, and there are mainly two variables that allow marketers to set a price. They are value and cost. A traditional approach considers production as a starting point to set a price. And this cost-based pricing is good for commodities, but it can be counterproductive for different types of offerings. Let's say that a company set a price according to the overall cost from making to selling a product, and then it adds a markup to make profit. But how can a company know if the consumer would have paid more for that product? Is the markup enough, or could it be raised? You see that in this model, there is the risk to underestimate the price. The value-based price is the opposite, and pricing starts from consumers' perceived value. How much the consumer is willing to pay for the offering. This model represents a modern approach to pricing, and it is actually very effective for most products and services. Starting from the value attributed by the consumer allows companies to generate the right margins from the demand. Nevertheless, it requires an excellent knowledge of the target audience. Now that we have understood the two models, value-based and cost-based, what is a pricing strategy? Given a target audience, a pricing strategy is a marketing action taken to give the best price to a product or service. There are mainly five pricing strategies. The first one is price skimming, when companies set a premium price to attract high-end consumers who doesn't mind dealing with expensive prices. Penetration pricing is when companies set low prices to penetrate a competitive market. It can also be used to attract consumers who seek convenience. A prestige pricing is a psychological strategy based on the principle that people make assumptions on the quality price ratio and don't buy if the price is too low. And it happens with luxury brands. Think of a $10 Gucci bag. It doesn't have value at all. People buy expensive and luxury brands to stand out and be recognized as members of a specific exclusive social class or category. A competition-oriented pricing is when companies study and apply competitors' price. Psychological pricing is when companies set prices slightly lower the rounded number. For example, all prices that end with 9. The third element of the 4 P's of marketing mix is promotion, and it represents all the advertising activities programs used to foster a product or a service. And it varies according to the segment served and specific marketing strategy chosen. The last P of the marketing mix is place, and it provides access to a service or product. It doesn't matter if it is intangible or tangible. It can be a store or an e-commerce, it doesn't matter. The most important thing is that people are able to buy this product or service. About 20 years after the formulation of the 4 P's of marketing mix, the community of economists and theorists started thinking of a more complete model to suit the complexity of services. In 1881, two professors, Bernard Booms and Mary Bittner presented the 7 P's of marketing mix. This updated version added 3 P's to the original model, which are people, physical evidence, and process. People represent everyone in the buyer's journey, buyer themselves included. The people dimension is very important in marketing mix because mood, character, and behavior adopted during the delivery of a service can affect consumers' perception of the quality of that service. And it doesn't concern only employees because, for example, if a service satisfies multiple consumers in the same time, they can influence each other. Just think of being at the cinema. If people start crunching while you are watching the movie, they decrease the quality of your experience. You get upset and you can't follow the story anymore. Instead, the processes are all the mechanism, planning, and decision making that ensure a smooth delivery of a product or service. They can be designing processes, flow charting, deciding between standardization versus personalization, locating fail points, critical incidents and system failures, monitoring and tracking service performance, analyzing resource requirements and allocation, creating and measuring key performance indicators, KPIs, aligning with guidelines, preparing operational manuals, and many others. Physical evidence represents all the environmental elements that surround consumers during the delivery of a product or service. They are characterizing factors that can positively or negatively impact the purchasing process. They can be interior design, colors, layout, equipment, furniture, or facilities. This dimension comprehends also the phase before and after the sale. For example, souvenirs and invoices are physical evidence that underline the fact that the product or service was delivered. Booms and Bittner stated that the physical evidence is the service delivered and any tangible goods that facilitate the performance and communication of the service. According to marketing and management of Kotler and Keller, marketing mix needs 8 P's to be fulfilled, and this concept is based on holistic marketing, which is an interdisciplinary and interconnected subject based on 4 pillars: relationship marketing, integrated marketing, internal marketing, and performance marketing. I've already explained this concept deeply in another video, so I linked it in the description below if you want to watch it. But anyway, the 8 P's of marketing mix starts from the 4 P's and adds people, processes, programs, and performance. Programs represent the integrated marketing aspects. Specifically, it enables marketers to consider a company's overall portfolio of marketing activities before starting a new one. In this way, all marketing strategies and systems are integrated and supported by each other. This whole of marketing activities, offline and online, it doesn't matter, can successfully pursue multiple goals of the firm. Instead, performance, in brief, represents all the financial and non-financial outcomes of a company. It represents implications that go beyond the classic revenue or profit concepts. In fact, it includes elements such as profitability, brand equity, customer equity, social responsibility, legal responsibility, ethical responsibility, and other. In 1890, the professor of advertising, Robert Lauterborn, presented a different version of the 4 P's of marketing mix, and actually he presented his model, the 4 C's of marketing mix: consumer, cost, convenience, and communication. Consumer means that companies should sell what people need and want. The starting point is an in-depth analysis and understanding of the target audience. Only in this way it is possible to make the best offering. Cost represents the total cost of ownership for a product or service, because the price is only a little part of the cost for consumers. Lauterborn explains how other factors, like time for assessing the offering, effort for changing or implementing the new product or service, or just the choice for not selecting a competitor's product, affect the purchasing cost. In his model, he also mentioned 2 interesting concepts: the cost of conscience and cost of guilt. Cost of conscience comes into play when consumers buy something that has a social, ethical, or broader implications. For example, many people, maybe also you, like the fast furniture of IKEA. But actually, the business model of IKEA is increasing mass deforestation and other social and environmental problems. Instead, the cost of guilt strikes every time a company tries to evoke guilt feelings in consumers' minds. And it doesn't have to be a negative message, because companies can just represent their offering as the solution of people's guilt. Parents feel guilty when they don't treat their kids when they are at the supermarket and they want candies. In 1873, the professor Koichi Shimotsu presented a different alternative from the four C's of marketing mix. Shimotsu created what it is called the seven C's compass model, which is a framework tailored to master co-marketing variables. Co-marketing is a model of marketing where one or more companies work together to pursue a common goal. They unite to market, promote, and communicate a common offer in different channels. It can be a piece of content, a co-branded product or service, or something else. Co-marketing differentiates from co-branding because the latter is when companies combine their expertise or a product or service characteristics to make a superior offering. Shimotsu's co-marketing concept includes a broader range of activities, including co-creative and commensal marketing. Co-creative is a marketing strategy which involves consumers in the creative process. For example, companies can give away a beta version of their product or service and gather people's feedback. Then they can use this feedback to improve the product. Or in the entertainment industry, co-creative is the strategy adopted by all the user-generated content platforms. Commensal marketing or symbiotic marketing is when companies are able to establish mutually satisfying relationships with other organizations or consumers. The first to explore this concept was Lee Adler in 1966, who stated, "Symbiotic marketing is an alliance of resources or programs between two or more independent organizations designed to increase the market potential of each." For example, in 2001, Kellogg and Mueller started a joint venture and launched a new yogurt with cereals. So consumers could open the yogurt, pour the cereals, and taste a new amazing mix. As you can see from the image, the Koichi Shimotsu 7 C's of Compass model are corporation, which is the core, the center, and it is intended as a whole of competitors, organizations, and stakeholders. Commodity is represented by co-created goods and services, as I have already mentioned before in co-marketing. Cost is the same as Robert Lauterbur defined in his four C's of marketing mix. Channel is represented by marketing channels needed to transfer a product or service from the point of production to the point of consumption. They can consist of people, organizations, and activities. Also, communication is like Robert Lauterbur has defined in his four C's of marketing mix. Instead, consumer, like the cardinal directions NSEW, their needs, security, education, and wants. Circumstances are external, uncontrollable, environmental elements surrounding a company. The first is national or international environment, which refers to political, legal, and ethical factors. Then there are social and cultural, economic, and weather. And as you can see, this marketing mix was criticized for including consumers because they represent the purpose of marketing, while all the other dimensions are tactics. While a marketing mix highlights the key dimensions of a marketing strategy, what actually is a marketing strategy? This image represents the main four marketing strategies. The first row of the image represents the competitive advantage, CA, from the supply point of view. Low cost and consumers perceive differentiation. The first column depicts the competitive advantage from the demand, industry, and segment. In this scheme, industry is intended as a wider portion of the market compared to a segment. A cost leader is very efficient in manufacturing, and logistics, and it works with high volume of standardized products. It gives bonuses according to quantity-based objectives and relies on low margins. In a few words, a cost leader uses one single marketing mix. A differentiating marketing strategy aims at increasing brand esteem and making unique services or products. Companies have to invest a lot in research and development and marketing communication. They must be creative and they usually focus on low quantities, but they can rely on higher margins. Differentiators have multiple marketing mix according to the target audience and offering. Focus on cost and focus on differentiation represent two marketing strategies based on an additional focus on the competitive advantage. If a cost leader targets a specific segment, it must be a master in lowering its cost. Examples can be the organic food, energy drinks, and something like this. Focus on differentiation aims at a niche, so the offering must be special and totally tailored. In 1866, the mathematician and business manager Igor Ansoff published his book Corporate Strategy, where he explained how to do basic growth marketing strategies. Marketing penetration is the strategy to adopt when a company wants to acquire more customers in the same market by using the same product or service. It can lower the prices and generously invest in advertising, PR, and communication. For these reasons, a market penetration strategy requires a huge amount of money. A market development strategy is when a company wants to attack new markets with the same product or service. Two of the most common tactics are partnering with companies which operate in a different industry but target the same or similar audience, and extending the use of the product or service to broaden the target audience. A company can grow in the same market by making new products with a product development strategy. It has to invest in research and development and continuous field tests to validate new products. Usually, the new creations are strictly connected with each other because they have to target the same group of people. They can be either brand new or upgrades of existing products. An example of product development can be a full line of supplements for running. You can have solutions for energy recovery, endurance, training, and so on. Plus, you can let customers choose between capsules or powder. A differentiation strategy is when a company wants to expand in different markets with new products. Besides their research and development investments, it has to study new target audience, acquire additional expertise, and make personalized offerings. This strategy is risky and expensive. That's why companies can create joint ventures or merges to compensate the lack of skills, knowledge, and equipment. An example can be Dollar Shave Club, which started by selling online razors, and now it covers the whole range of men beauty care. Razors, shaving accessories, creams and butters, deodorants and wipes, and shower soaps. In conclusion, personalization and differentiation always require more than one marketing mix. Instead, approaching the market without considering consumers' preferences requires just one marketing mix. So now, tell me your opinion. In this modern era for startups, which is the best marketing strategy? Should they have one marketing mix or multiple marketing mix? Tell me yours in the comment below. I'm really curious to hear you out. If you like this video, subscribe to my channel. Every week I come up with a digital marketing lesson. Push the like button. Thank you for watching and see you soon.